every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Upon your love, it is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your. No. open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me into the love.
Sing it one more time. Holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is something inside. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around.
Amen. You guys may be seated. As you know, today is Independence Day, right? Got a couple flags hanging up. I was just thinking before we do our message, I just wanted to share a couple things about our country. You know, there's a lot of greatness in America. Yeah, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in America. But you know what? There's a lot of great things about our country. We have been known for liberating other nations throughout the world. We have been known for fighting for freedom and helping others throughout the world. Our response to national disasters throughout the world, disaster relief, building hospitals, clothing, and feeding the needy and hurting people. The United States is far above other countries in doing those things. Our Statue of Liberty has a sign on it, or a plaque. It says, "Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore." On the Liberty Bell, this is a Bible verse, "Proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto the inhabitants thereof." That says it, that's out of Leviticus. Millions of people still try to get into this country every year. Even as we speak, people are trying to get in here because they see something. They see freedom. Every year, America sends missionaries to countries throughout the world to tell about the true freedom that's in Jesus Christ. That's what America does. I saw this thing, six things that make America great. One, our beginning. We were escaping tyranny in another country. We wanted religious freedom to worship as we wanted to see fit, and we came over here. And there were some people that knew that there was natives and Indians here, and they wanted to share the gospel. Some people came for different reasons, but then when we got here, we couldn't really break away from the British Empire, and there was a yoke of bondage through tyranny, and we started this new experiment, if you will, called America. There's also our Constitution. Our Constitution, which talks about how, you know, that we were conceived in liberty, and we were dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal, and that this is a nation under God, and shall have a nation of freedom, that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth. This is different than a lot of other countries. Our land is one of the most beautiful, fruitful, and more resources than almost any nation on the planet. We can provide everything we need here. We've been able to do that, and we've been able to take all those things and to share them with other countries throughout the world. Our people, we're the most diversified bunch of people in the planet. Everybody comes to America. They call it the melting pot because of their freedoms and the different things. Also, our opportunities. In America, it provides an amazingly good life for the ordinary person. You go to some countries, and it's either they're all rich and they're like dirt poor. There's like no middle ground. In America is also the opportunity that if you work hard and you have a good work ethic and you treat people right, you can make something happen. It's been said 80% of the millionaires in America, they're all self-made. No one handed it to them. They worked their tail off. And that's the land of opportunity that we have. And also, we have our freedom, equality. America has gone further than any society in establishing the equality of rights. We know that there's been some bad things going on in our country, especially in the past with slavery. We talked about that. The Bible addresses that. But you know what? America is also one of the countries that actually abolished slavery. And believe it or not, it was mostly white people that did all the work to do that. And there's been a lot of freedoms. It's not perfect. We're still working through it. But we are trying to do the best we can, more than a whole lot of other countries have done, because slavery is in so many other places of the world. And it's not right. It's not good. But we're doing the best we can. And I was thinking about it. It was a guy named Alexis de Tocqueville. I don't know if I got his last name right. He was a Frenchman. He just saw this country in America just blossoming, and they're like, "What is this? Is a great country. We got to see what's going on over there." He started looking around. He goes, "Well, it's not in the industry. It's not in the fruitful plains. It's not in the hard work ethic. It's not in these great ideas and these innovators, because a lot of people in America invented things. A lot of stuff came out of America that's been going through the world." This is what he said: "Not until I went into the churches of America and heard her pulpits aflame with righteousness did I understand the secret of her genius and power. America is great because she is good. And if America ever ceases to be good, she will cease to be great." There was another guy that was looking at America, and he came up with this thing called the Golden Triangle. Freedom requires virtue. Virtue requires faith. And faith requires freedom. He's basically talking about those three things go together. You can't have just two of those. You got to have all three of them. To have freedom, you got to have virtue. You got to have morality. You got to have a desire to do the right thing. And that only comes through religion, the Christian faith, the power of Jesus working in us through the, and we have the Ten Commandments and the Holy Spirit working. We are able to do those good things and fight for freedom and those types of things. They go together. Thomas Jefferson put it this way: "Can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that those liberties are the gift of God, that they are violated but with his wrath? I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just and that his justice cannot sleep forever." We need to take heed to that. Ben Franklin in 1787, walking out of the Continental Congress, somebody was asking him about the government. "What kind of government do we have? Is it a republic or a monarchy? He said, "A republic, madame, if you can keep it." You got to fight. You got to fight to get freedom, but you got to fight to keep freedom, and that's what we're doing. I told you about the other day about the so-called separation of church and state, which is not even in the Constitution. It was pulled from a letter from Thomas Jefferson many years ago when the Danbury Baptists were worried about their religious freedoms. Because this is what the First Amendment says: "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." They never say that second part. "Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion." That was like, we're not, the state religion isn't going to be Baptist. It's not going to be Lutheran. It's not going to be Episcopal or Episcopalian. We're not going to do that like they did in other countries. But the second half is, "or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." That's what happens in our country. People have come and turned the laws around where you can't even exercise your freedoms anymore. And I love what this was said: "The First Amendment's actual purpose was to protect people of faith from the government, not to protect the government from faith or people of faith." Let me say it again. "The First Amendment's actual purpose was to protect people of faith from the government, not to protect the government from faith or people of faith." Behind me is the American flag. You see the colors. I always thought the red was for the blood of that was shed in our battles, and some people say that, but I saw some things. It means hardiness and valor. The white signifying purity and innocence, and the blue signifying vigilance, perseverance, and justice. You know, but there's also a Christian flag. You know the Christian flag? It's got the same colors. And the red is for the blood of Christ. That's the true liberty. The white is for purity, and then the blue is for royalty because of Jesus. So we're going to do something here. Who here loves our country? Who here believes we need to pray for our country? What we're going to do is we're going to take about 5 minutes, and I want to see us break up in groups of like maybe 3 people, maybe 4 at the most, and let's just pray for America. However God sees fit. If you want to see godly people in office, if you want to see some law overturned or whatever, just get a handful of people and let's pray for our country, and then we're going to come back and we're going to start our message. So just break up in groups of like 3 or 4 for about 5 minutes, and we're going to pray for our country. It's good to see we got a lot of people praying. Some of you are like, I don't want to stop. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to transition into our message, but I'm going to invite somebody up here. Mr. Bart, would you come here? Before, I don't know why we're clapping for him, but Bart, they love you, man. Why don't you stand up? Bart is going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance before we...
Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, you got to remain standing. You know why? We're reading God's word. See, you know it. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 11 this morning. I'm going to pause while people turn to it because I think I start reading too quickly, assuming you guys are there. That's okay, though. Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11, verse 1. Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Then they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They had brick for stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, indeed, the people are one, and they all have one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of the earth, and they ceased building the city. Therefore its name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. Verse 10. This is the genealogy of Shem. Shem was 100 years old, and he begot Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. After he begot Arphaxad, Shem lived 500 years and begot sons and daughters. Arphaxad lived 35 years and begot Salah. After he begot Salah, Arphaxad lived 403 years and begot sons and daughters. Salah lived 30 years and begot Eber. After he begot Eber, Salah lived 403 years and begot sons and daughters. Eber lived 34 years and begot Peleg. After he begot Peleg, Eber lived 430 years and begot sons and daughters. Peleg lived 30 years and begot Reu. After he begot Reu, Peleg lived 209 years and begot sons and daughters. Reu lived 32 years and begot Serug. After he begot Serug, Reu lived 207 years and begot sons and daughters. Serug lived 30 years and begot Nahor. After he begot Nahor, Serug lived 200 years and begot sons and daughters. Nahor lived 29 years and begot Terah. After he begot Terah, Nahor lived 119 years and begot sons and daughters. Now Terah lived 70 years and begot Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Verse 27. This is the genealogy of Terah. Terah begot Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Haran begot Lot. And Haran died before his father Terah in the native land in Ur of the Chaldeans. Then Abram and Nahor took wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, and the father of Iscah. But Sarah was barren. She had no child. And Terah took his son Abram and his grandson Lot, the son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, his son Abram's wife, and they went out with him from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to the land of Canaan, and they came to Haran and dwelt there. So the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Father, as we look to your word, Father, give me wisdom as I open this word up to us all, Lord. We want you to be glorified through the teaching of your word. I pray that you would increase and I would decrease. They would not be my words, they'd be your words. But Lord, also help us to listen with application, that we would listen with understanding and ask ourselves, okay, what does this mean to me? What would you want me to apply to my life? So we pray, bless this time in God's word, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Last week, the message was preparing for a kingdom without God. And now we are coming to the kingdom without God that they're trying to build. In chapter 10 and the first handful of verses in chapter 11, there is no mention of God whatsoever. No mention of God, no mention of the Lord, no mention of the Holy Spirit, nothing about God. But yet we read here that the whole earth had one language and one speech. So it almost kind of sounds like there's some unity going on here. The sad thing is there's unity, yes, but there's unity without God. Unity without God is not a good thing. And that's what's taking place right here. And it says, if you look at verse 2 and 3 and 4, which talk about this building project, it's talking about them. They journeyed. They found the plain. They dwelt there. They said to one another, they had brick for stone. They had asphalt. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heaven. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the earth. This is all about self. There's no kingdom of God here. This is all about man. And on first glance, it may look kind of innocent. But you know what? God knows what he's seen in the past. He first put Adam and Eve in the most beautiful place in the history of the world, the Garden of Eden. Every single one of their needs were met. They said, you just walk in me, with me, enjoy this paradise. And what do we see? They sinned against God in the garden. And the next thing you know, their first two boys, Cain murdered Abel, and they already had murder. And then it started getting evil. And then they brought another child in named Seth. He was the appointed one. And then you know what the last verse of chapter 4 says? Then men began to call on the name of the Lord. It's kind of like God's like, wow, so it took a whole four chapters before you guys would call on me, the creator of the universe. And that's where God wants us to be. I'm so glad you guys were praying a minute ago. God is looking for men and women that are going to pray not only for things to get done, like we want to see things in our nation get done, and we want safety, and we want whatever. You want health and prosperity and healed marriages and all that stuff. But we also pray to have a relationship with God. God has called us to have a relationship with him. He's called us to walk in harmony with him. But then as we follow, we've been telling you the last few chapters that all of a sudden the people that were on the earth just became evil. They were corrupt. They were in sexual immorality. You had these tyrants that were just bullying people around, pushing people around. And it says there was corruption. It says there was violence filled the earth, and every thought and intent of theirs was only evil continually. And God got to a point where he said, it's enough. I've given you time to repent, but you're not only sinning, you're killing people, you're doing violence against other people. That's it. That's not what I created you for. And the flood came. And Noah and his family, the righteous that were left over, only 8 people got into that boat. We call it the SS Salvation because that's a type of what Jesus is. He brings salvation to anybody who wants to come with him. But only 8 people came in there. And you know what? He told them the same thing. Noah, when they got out of the boat, he told them the same thing he told Adam. Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Well, if you look here, it says, and they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. They didn't want to go out for the whole earth. They wanted to stay together, and they wanted to build a kingdom. But it's a kingdom without God. You know, the Bible talks about not building your own kingdom. In fact, if you look at the Lord's Prayer, part of the Lord's Prayer is your kingdom come and your will be done. It's not got nothing to do with man's kingdom. When man builds his kingdom, it's not good. When man builds his kingdom and God's not in it, he justifies sin. It's all about him. He does a lot of evil things. When you get God out of society, and that's one of the reasons our nation is going through such turmoil, is for years God has been pushed out, pushed out, pushed out. The one thing that made this nation great was our faith in God, because he brought morality to us. He brought us a conscience. And even though we've never been perfect, we've been courageous. We've done a lot of great things. And people have tried to push that out. They're trying to push God out. But when you push God out, it all falls apart. When you push God out, you justify sin. You say stuff like, okay, this is not really adultery. It's cheating on my wife or my husband. It's an affair. They try to doctor up to make it sound like it's not so bad. When you have homosexuality, what the Bible says is another sin, it's an abomination to the Lord. They say, no, this is a gay lifestyle. This is a gay, it's an alternate lifestyle. When you start saying stuff like killing a baby is murder, we do something like, oh no, it's just terminating a pregnancy. You know, it's all about the woman's rights. It's about her. They don't tell you that. When you talk about alcoholism, the Bible calls drunkenness a sin. When you know what we call it in America? Oh, it's a disease. It's not your fault. And then, okay, so if it's a disease, why do we put it in bottles and cans and sell it not only in liquor stores and bars, but why do we sell it at ball games, at restaurants, at supermarkets? Hello? And that's what happens when you get God out. You start doing your own thing. You start justifying it. And it just gets worse from there. And God knows all this. God is like a heavenly father looking down on his children saying, this is not good. I know where this is going to go. And so God comes in and steps in. But it says, come, let us build ourselves a city. It doesn't say, come, let us build a city. Let's build ourselves a city. With no mention of God. And then it says, and a tower whose top is in the heavens. See, what the Tower of Babel, it was this massive structure. No one really knows how big it was, but a lot of people think is what they would call a ziggurat, where it was a place. Sometimes it might have a ramp that went around it, or it'd have bricks, but they'd have some stairway. But at the very top, the idea was they would go up there, and then they would worship the host of heaven, but they wouldn't worship the maker of heaven. And all throughout the Old Testament, you see this reference to high places. High places where pagan worship would come. They'd go up and they'd worship the stars. They worship demons. They worship other entities or whatever you want to call them, deities, if you will. And often involved in that would be human sacrifice. In fact, not only human sacrifices, but they would often have sexual, they would have prostitutes in some of these religions where they would offer sex to these gods, just all kinds of wickedness. And in the Old Testament, when a king came into Israel, they always say he did good in the sight of the Lord or he did evil in the sight of the Lord. If he did good in the sight of the Lord, he would do the right thing. He would make some reform or some changes. But if he was really good, he'd destroy the high places. That's what guys like Josiah did, Hezekiah. They went and destroyed the high places. And God told the children of Israel, when you go into the land, you destroy the high places, you destroy everything, lest they teach you your ways. You know who didn't learn that? Solomon. Solomon was such a gifted man, anointed man of the Lord. He had everything the world has to offer. And you know what he did? Check this out. This is what the Bible says. He had, 700 wives and concubines and 700 wives and 300 concubines and princesses. It's like crazy. So he was like living the flesh on steroids. He took everything, every indulgence that he could, but all of a sudden these wives turned his heart from the Lord. He built high places, allowed them to build high places to the gods of the heavens, but not the God of heaven. And then he got judged, and Israel got judged, and all that stuff happened, and it was just so sad to see all this take place. But the high places need to be destroyed. And it says, whose top is in heaven? Well, Babel is also, is Babylon. And it's going to be Babylon. But it's also a reference to the Babylon in the end times, like Nimrod, the guy who builds this city. Notice how it says, come let us make a name for ourselves. The only name is Nimrod. Nimrod was like back in chapter 10, verse 8 and 9 and 10. Nimrod began to be a mighty one on the earth. He was a mighty hunter. There's none like him, Nimrod. See, and that's how evil leaders are. Evil leaders get people to work for them and even enslave people, thinking that they're helping them. Hey, you need me. You need us. I'm here for your safety. I'm here to make life better for you. And all of a sudden, this guy becomes rich and this guy becomes famous, and they start doing stuff for him, and they don't realize it, that they're being enslaved. That's kind of what Nimrod did. Nimrod, they're building a name for themselves. I don't see a name for themselves. There's a name for Nimrod. It's the only famous name here. But God knows that. This is what the Bible says. Let another man praise you, not your own lips. Who is the man after God's own heart? David. David was a man after God's own heart. Who were two of his biggest enemies? Saul and who else? Who was the guy, who was the first person to try and take his kingdom? No, he already had, after that, Absalom. You know what Absalom and King Saul did? They built monuments to themselves. Great men don't build monuments to themselves. Great men, when they die, somebody else builds a monument because they were great men. These guys, while they're living, built monuments to themselves. And they were both against God's purposes. And that's what happens. When you try to build a name for yourself, you're out of harmony with God. See, pride is like the top sin, if you will. If you look at the seven things that God hates in chapter 6 of Proverbs, the first one is a proud look. And after pride comes everything else. Pride is all about me, about what I can do, what I want. You think you're better than people. You won't humble yourself. You won't listen to correction. You won't serve people. It's all about what you can get. You'll see jealousy. You'll see anger. You'll see all kinds of evil, greed, violence, all kinds of things come out of pride. And that's what's happening here. These people are prideful. You know, and what's really sad is our country, or not our country, but some in our country, last month tried to celebrate pride. But it wasn't just pride, it was pride of sin. It's bad enough to be prideful, but when you're prideful of your sin and you try and push it on people, it gets really bad. In fact, my wife showed me this comedian. He was on a golf course, and he's going, okay, and he's like talking to the phone. He goes, okay, I get it, Pride Month. This is what you want to do. You want the rainbow, the colors. I get it, I get it. You want us to embrace it. You want us to celebrate with you. I get it, I get it. And then he turns his phone, because he's on a golf course, and he sees a rainbow. He goes, but really, a rainbow? How expensive it was for you guys to build that rainbow? I mean, that's a lot of work for you guys, you know? It was just funny the way he said it, but obviously it was funnier when me and her read it, but... Anyways, but that's what pride was. Pride, they want people to embrace their sin. But the thing is, this is the thing, is it doesn't stop there. Pride is never satisfied. Pride always wants to go forward. And I'm going to touch base on that in a minute here too. But then he says, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. Did you know the Lord sees all? Remember I was telling you about Solomon? He knew something about that. Solomon wrote the book of Proverbs, and he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon. But Ecclesiastes was almost like I wouldn't say it was an autobiography, but in it he talks about how he tried everything. He tried women. He tried wine. He tried building projects. He tried pride. He tried to seek wisdom. He just gave himself over to the lusts of his flesh. And you know what he said? This is the last thing he said in Ecclesiastes 12:13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. God sees all. We think he just sees what we see. God sees in the dark. God says the things you whisper at dark will be spoken of off the housetops. God sees everything. And what he's doing is he sees what's going on here. He sees this building this city that's being built, and he's not liking what he sees. And like I said, he's like a father that knows what's going to happen, because he says in verse 6, and the Lord said, indeed the people are one, and they all have one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. This is what they begin to do. This is what I was saying. When somebody builds a kingdom without God, and pride is one of the motivating forces, it will never be satisfied. Evil will never be satisfied. That's where it's beginning. He says, this is going to get worse if I don't come in there. When I was a young Christian, one of the big topics was there were people trying to pass homosexual marriage, gay marriage. And they were trying to redefine it, which they did in some places. But that's God's call. God made marriage, not man. You can call it whatever you want, but God's marriage is a biological man and a biological woman in a committed relationship. Is it because he's mean? Is it because he's mean and he doesn't want you to have fun? No, because he knows what's best for you. He knows the best relationship is a committed relationship where you work together through your problems and you see things through. You realize the richness of that, and you only give your sexuality to that person. You don't give it to anybody else, and it's preserved. It's precious. The Bible says marriage is honorable among all and the bed undefiled, but fornicators and adulterers God will judge. That's God's word. That's not my word. That's not Impact Bible Fellowship's word. That's God's word. But God knows best. So when I was a Christian, young Christian, and James Dobson, Focus on Family, says, okay, this is what they're doing, but I'm telling you right now, this is only the start. And they're like, oh, no, let's just let them vote it in. No big, just let them vote it in. It's not a big deal. It's a free country. He's saying this is where it's going to start. And what's happened since then? It's not just the L and the G and the B. It's a T and the Q and blah, 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 blah. And now they're trying to, there's people that are trying to say it's okay to get your sex changed. You're telling God that he made a mistake when you do that. I don't care who you are. You have been made in the image of God. And you are a blessing if you realize that. Your identity is in the Lord. Your identity is not in your sexuality or whatever. That's a lie from the devil. But now it's bad enough that there's people that want to do that. They want to push that on our children. That's why when we were praying, one of the people in our prayer group just a minute ago, they were there praying for the education system. Our schools have kicked God out. They took prayer out. They took Bible reading out. They took all morality out. And they're indoctrinating and they're teaching garbage to our kids like that. And what he's saying is this is what they begin to do. That's why we need to do what we're doing is fight the good fight. Tell people the truth. There's a God in heaven that loves them. And he sent his son Jesus. That you can have forgiveness of sins and you will not be judged for your sins. And you'll go to heaven for all eternity in a place called heaven. That's an amazing place. But that's what we're here for. But then he says, one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Like I said, it will never stop. They're going to be emboldened like, hey, we were able to do this. Let's do this. We were able to do this. Let's do this. And I was kind of thinking about this. Like, let's say you're a father. Let's say you have a kid that plays baseball, and he's really good. But he knows he's good, and he brags about it. I'm the best baseball player on the team, Dad. None of these kids are any good. I'm the only good ball player. And he just starts bragging. Dad's going to say, son, that is a bad attitude. And if the attitude continues, you're always going to say, you're off the team. Dude, your season's done. He goes, God didn't give you a talent to make you think you're better than people. And he knows if he doesn't correct him, if he doesn't stop him, that kid is going to grow up to be a spoiled brat. He's going to think he's better than everybody that he comes in contact with, because the Bible says God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. That was one of the time-tested principles of life that comes from the Bible. God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. And so God's going, oh man, these guys are so full of pride, man. If I don't stop them, this is gonna get bad. So he comes down there and he says, come, let us go down there, confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. Come, let us. The last time we heard come, let us was, and when it says us, it's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It's like they're having a little council in heaven. The last time we heard the word us, it said, let us come down and make man in our image. Let them have dominion over the earth. Let them be fruitful and multiply. God was coming down with blessing. But you know what? They stiff-armed God, like, I don't want your way. I want to do my thing. And that's basic humanity. And now he's coming down with correction. Let's go down and there confuse their language that they may not understand one another's speech. And you know, I was thinking about this. It says, he scattered them abroad from there over the face of the earth, and they ceased building this city. Therefore, its name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the earth. So they got this big building project, and apparently it's being successful. And then God comes down and confuses it, you know? So you go to work the next day, and all of a sudden, hey, how's it going, man? Bonjour. Bonjour, merci, coup de grâce. I'm like, what's that, you know? Then someone else says, Toyota, Kawasaki, Nagasaki, you know, Saki, Tora, Tora, Tora. What's that? You know, then someone sneezes, and someone says, Gesundheit, huh? Deals Taben Diga, huh? And they're like, what are these guys saying, you know? And all of a sudden, they're trying to work together, you know, and someone's trying to do something, and some guy says, ¿Qué está haciendo? Huh? Adios, muchachos. Arrivederci. Sayonara. Goodbye. Boom. And they split. They cannot communicate. They're trying to get a trial, and he doesn't know what he's talking about. They're trying to get more, like, I know what he's talking about. So they dispersed, and they went all directions. That's what we talked about here in chapter 10. In verse 5, it says, from these the coastland people, the Gentiles, were separated into their lands, everyone according to his language, according to their families, and into their nations. And verse 20, the same thing about the sons of Ham. And verse 31, the same thing about the sons of Shem. And then verse 32 of chapter 10, These were the families of the sons of Noah according to their generations in their nations, and from these nations were divided on the earth after the flood. So they got separated. They went throughout the whole earth after this. And it says they separated in languages according to families. So it's almost like this little group went with their family, this group went with their family, and there were all these multiple languages. They went all over the place. And I thought it was interesting because remember I told you guys about the Ark Encounter back there in Kentucky? Ken Ham answers to Genesis. He built this amazing ark. I said, you got to put on your Christian bucket list. Well, they're building something else. They're building the Tower of Babel. They're building the Tower of Babel because what they want to do is they want to show that racism has been around forever, but that's not God's plan. God's plan was he came in to unify, but these guys were unifying without God, and that's where everything falls apart. So they kind of disperse, but they're going to have this thing that's going to show the people coming from the flood, and God's telling them to disperse, but they decide to go together and build this big old city to build it to their gods. And God's going to come and confuse them. And then they're going to go look at it, and when they come out, they're going to come in, and they're going to have like somebody who might have been there, like some chief of some tribe that left there, and he's going, yeah, I remember when Noah's sons did this, and we all got together, and it was just weird, and we were building this thing. And they're going to give the gospel presentation in there, and they're going to tell people that Jesus is the unifier. Jesus is the answer to racism and all this other garbage that the world tries to breed. And I love, because it says in Acts 17:26, I've shared this verse about four or five times. I believe every Christian should memorize this verse. Acts 17:26 says, and he, God, has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. I love that because God is saying that we all come from one blood. We all come from the same people. We're all brothers and sisters. I mean, seriously, we all have two eyes, we all have a nose, we all have feet, we all have elbows, just our skin color, maybe a few little things are different, and the world or the enemy or the devil tries to get people to divide over this. That's what bugs me about all this garbage that's coming out today. And the other thing that they want to do is they want to refute CRT, which is critical race theory, which tries to teach that every white person is prejudiced and is a love slavery and stuff like that. And it's just really ugly. But I was thinking, the very person who was one of the greatest men in our country was Martin Luther King Jr. And you know what he said? I dream of the day when people will be judged by the context of their character, not the color of their skin. That's what's happening right now, is they're trying to get people to judge people by their sin and to take sides and to be at each other's throat. This is what the Bible says about my Savior and your Savior if you're a Christian, the Lord Jesus Christ. Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male or female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. There was a couple amens out there. You guys are getting it. That's an amen moment. See, and then one of the biggest racial divides, believe it or not, was the Jews and the non-Jews. Are they called Gentiles? So we talked about this earlier, how God had told the Jews, you guys are going to be a priesthood of, you're going to be a nation of priests. You're going to be the light to the Gentiles, to the non-believing world. But what did they do? They kept it to themselves. They got built up with pride, and they looked down on the Gentiles, and they wouldn't give them the time of day. That's not the Lord. And now we, the church, are the light of the world. The Bible says you, as a Christian, you're a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are his own special people who have been called to proclaim the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. You're getting it. Those are amen moments. Guys, this is why God has created us. When Jesus said, I have come to give you life and that more abundantly, it wasn't I just came to give you whatever you want. It's I came to get you to heaven, but I came to give you a life worth living. The abundant life is a life worth living for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, where we use our lives to make a difference. That's what God wants to do with you and I. You know, because we're going to go down here now, and we're going to read kind of, not really quickly, but we just read about the genealogy. Okay, now we're getting into Shem's geology, because Shem is going to lead to a man named Abraham. Right here, it's called Abram. His name's going to be changed. But Abraham is going to be a blessing. Okay? So if you look here, it says that this is a genealogy, verse 27. It talks about Terah, the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran begot Lot. Well, why is that significant? Well, Lot's going to play a big role in the next few chapters, but sadly, it's going to be a negative. It's going to be a negative on him. But it says, Haran died before his father, Terah, in the native land in Ur of the Chaldeans. And then it talks about how, in verse 31, then Terah took his son Abram and his grandson Lot, the son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the son of Abram's wife, and they went out from there from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to the land of Canaan, and they came to Haran and dwelt there. And so the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Iran. Now look at verse 12, chapter 1, chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. You shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. If you look in chapter 7 of Acts, Stephen is giving a defense of the faith, and he gives them like a history lesson of Israel. And in the first part of chapter 7, he tells us that God called Abram out of Ur of the Chaldeans. But look here what it says in chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country. But when we read this, we find out that he stayed in Ur of the Chaldeans until his dad decided to move to Haran. And it wasn't until his dad died in Haran that he went over to Canaan. What am I getting at? God called Abraham, and he kind of drug his feet. Some of us drag our feet. You know where I'm going? Do you remember when Jesus, well, I think it was in Luke chapter 9, it's actually in a few places, but Jesus was preaching and someone says, Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go. And Jesus says, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And then he goes, and he says, well, let me first go bury my father. Remember that one? Isn't that like a weird one? It's like dad's dying or dead and you're going to bolt out of there? This is what happened. See, what happened is Abram was told to go to leave his family, and he didn't do it. He just kind of hung around with dad, and then dad moved to the next place, Haran, and then he waited for dad to die. And often what happens in this culture, and I think in some other cultures, is they wait till their family passes off and they can maybe get the inheritance, especially if they're the firstborn, they will get all those things. And God's saying, leave your family, leave your stuff, just go. And Abraham's dragging his feet. And Jesus told that to the people that want to follow him. And what he's saying is he wants us to be all in. When he calls us to go, he wants us to follow him. Who cares about the stuff? Who cares about what people say? Who cares about anything but what God says? That's what God's called you and I to be as followers of Jesus Christ, is to do what he said. Now, one of the great things about Abraham, because he's going to answer the call. It just takes a while. But he is the father of faith. And he's a man that would pray like you guys were doing earlier. He is what we call an intercessor. He prays for people. So last Monday, I went with a couple guys that our brother Dave started a prayer meeting at his work on Monday morning. So I went there and prayed with a handful of guys. And we were praying, and we just got done talking about Nimrod, and we were texting back and forth, and I think somebody said, don't be a Nimrod, be an Abraham. I thought, don't be a Nimrod, be an Abraham. I love that. Don't be a Nimrod who's saying, I'm going to build my kingdom. Be an Abraham who says, I'm going to leave everything and I'm going to pray for people. I'm going to be a light to the dark. I'm going to be a blessing to others. That's what God calls us to be. He wants us to be a blessing to others. Did you guys know that? You have been called not to be blessed, but to be a blessing. That's what discipleship is. You get discipled and you pour into other people and disciple them, and they can disciple others, and you pass on the faith. That's why you're always hearing me say, to all of these mothers that are pregnant and have had babies and are going to have babies, those are disciples in the making. We have been called to disciple them. We have been called to bless these little kids and to see them carry on the tradition of what we are all about. And you know what? I was thinking about this because earlier today, we're going to, Bob, our elder, he did a little devo. And his Devo was talking about remember and rejoice. And you know what he was talking about? He was talking about in the Old Testament, all of these, there's all these feasts that they would have, the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Weeks, the Feast of Trumpets, Passover meal, all these different things. And in almost all of them, they would say something like this: remember the Lord your God brought you out of Egypt. He was saying, you guys need to remember where you came from. Egypt was, they were in bondage. In fact, it was called the iron furnace. But God says he pulled them out by a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. He pulled them out. And he pulled them out of Egypt into the wilderness to eventually go into the promised land. And that's what God did to you and me. That's what communion's all about. See, we remember what God's done, but we also rejoice what God's done. Are you with me? I'm going to invite the worship team, and they're going to, right now, the worship team, they're going to come up and they're going to play a communion song. But I want to just make a couple mentions of that. And then after after they're done, I'm going to come up really quick, and then we're going to have some people share about communion, and we're going to pray over it. But communion is very similar to what the Israelites do when they would remember Egypt. We need to remember where we came from. We need to remember that God called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. And so as we come to the communion table, it also tells us to examine ourselves. Examine, are you in the faith? Examine yourself. Is there something that you're doing in your life that is not pleasing to the Lord? Is there something that, okay, how about this? Years ago, there was a guy named Evan Roberts. He was like the Billy Graham of the day, and they had a revival. And one of the things he said, there was three things that made this revival amazing. And it said that they obeyed the Holy Spirit, and they turned from any known sin, and they even turned from doubtful areas. How about that? See, we see sin, we see compromise, then there's doubtful areas. Doubtful areas will turn into compromise, will turn into sin. As I'm saying this right now, is there a doubtful area that you don't have a peace about, that God's putting on your heart right now? What he's saying is, you need to deal with that. You need to deal with that. Jesus said, if your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It's better to enter into heaven with one eye than to hell with two eyes. He said the same thing, if your arm causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better to enter heaven with one arm than be into hell with both arms. Now, that's not what he's really saying, is I really want you to do that. He's saying there are things that you got to get rid of, and they're very painful. It could be a wrong relationship. It could be a wrong workplace. It could be a wrong habit. It could be a wrong something that you're just starting to get involved in. And God's saying, if you don't cut that off, it's going to destroy you. So as the worship team gets ready to play, there's two things I want to say. Remember what God's done. Be grateful for it. But analyze it. Is there something in my life that God's telling me I need to fix or I need to change? And the second thing is, maybe there's some here that have never given their life to Jesus Christ. They don't know that they would go to heaven. They don't know that their sin is forgiven. This, I'm going to give an invitation when I come back up. And so think about that. Do you know, for without a shadow of doubt, if you were to die, that you would go to heaven? Do you know that? I hope and pray you do, because you should know it. And it's not got nothing to do with you. It's got everything to do with him. So we're going to play this song, and then I'm going to come up at the end, and then we're going to have communion. So let's just meditate as we sing this song, what the Lord would be telling us.
In the quiet, in the stillness, I know that you are God. In the secret of your presence, I know there I am restored. When you call, I won't refuse. None but Jesus. crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. In the chaos and confusion, I know your sovereign still. In the no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. Go ahead and sing it, church.
Hello, I'm going to invite Jordan and Mandy to come up and pray for communion, but before we do that, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. I earlier said, do you know that you would be going to heaven if you were to die? It's not about works. Father, I pray we would all realize it's not about works. It's about the work you did on the cross. All we need to do is repent and turn from our sin and follow you and accept you as our Lord and Savior. You said, my sheep hear my voice. I know them. They follow me. And I give them eternal life. If you want to get your life right with Jesus, just repeat this prayer after me and mean it from your heart. Dear Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Forgive me for what I have done. I promise to turn from my sin and to follow you all the days of my life. I believe, Jesus, you died on the cross to forgive me of my sin. And you rose again from the dead. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to have this couple come up and share.
Good morning. My name's Amanda, and this is my husband, Jordan. Just wanted to make sure I go over these little nifty cups right here. There's a clear little top tab for the first element, and then there's another tab underneath it for the second element. So when we were asked to do this communion, I have to admit, every ounce of my body was saying no, that we weren't ready, and that we were definitely not deserving of this honor. But my heart told me yes, that with insecurities come growing in faith. I had no clue where to begin, so I started from the beginning. Communion isn't an obligation as a Christian, but a celebration. So why do we take communion? We take communion regularly to give thanks, to examine ourselves in the life we are living, to prepare for the future God has planned for us, and to remember the sacrifice Jesus gave for us. So today I'll be reading out of Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." The bread symbolizes the body that was broken and beaten. When we take it, we are accepting that we need him. When we consume the bread, we are being fed what we need, both physically and spiritually. John chapter 6, verse 47 to 48 says, "I tell you the truth, anyone who believes has eternal life. Yes, I am the bread of life." Our body needs food to survive, and we need Jesus too. Jesus is our spiritual bread to keep us living. We are by no way perfect, and yet we are forgiven and protected and ultimately made whole. As a church family, we take communion together to share in this blessing because we are one body in Christ, not just with one another, but with God. We are sharing in this intimate time and have a privilege of growing together in every season of life. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we know we are sinners, and we know that you are the only way to satisfy our hunger. I thank you for allowing us to gather together to remember all you have done and the excruciating pain you experienced to save us. I ask you to examine our hearts as we celebrate your love and faithfulness. You have met our needs. Amen. Let's partake.
I'm going to be reading from Matthew chapter 26, verses 27 through 29. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remissions of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Growing up, I always remembered the song, "Nothing But the Blood of Jesus," not understanding fully what it was about. But as I read through some scriptures before I came to you today, I found that the true power of Jesus' blood really represents. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. I wrote, "We were redeemed and purchased by the sacrifice of Jesus' blood and his blood." Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19, it says, "Having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus." We can have an intimate relationship and fellowship with God through the blood of Jesus. In Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, "But he who was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." We have healing through the blood of Jesus. Because of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, we will get the chance to drink the fruit of the vine with Jesus in the kingdom of God. All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come today before you as the body of your Son, Jesus, and we remember the blood that was poured out for us so that we can be forgiven of our sins and that we can have eternal life. May we go forward and glorify you, Lord, and honor you in always remembering what Jesus did for us all. As he, a perfect man, your Son, gave up his life to be beaten and broken, and his blood poured out on the cross. We thank you, Jesus. We ask for your blessings upon us of strength, knowledge, wisdom, grace, forgiveness, and boldness to stand up against the evilness in this world, as we are here to glorify you, Jesus, and to be a testimony of your love and grace. Amen. Let us partake.
You all stand, please. While I hook up my umbilical cord. Hey, we're going to end in a prayer that we're going to sing. And it's a song that we probably don't often think is a prayer. But so let me pray it first, and then we'll sing it. God, bless America. Land that I know, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home sweet home. I mean, how many times do we pray for each other? We pray blessings upon each other. And that's what this song truly is. It's a prayer asking God to bless our nation. So, you know, as Pastor Marty shared earlier, we're celebrating this weekend and remembering not only our independence from the tyranny of England at the time, but our independence from sin through Christ Jesus. Amen.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies, to the ocean, white with foam. God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
Patrick getting kind of churchy there, huh?
God bless you guys, and tell somebody else today, God bless you. Have a good day.